بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله، أنا الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Few things before we begin, inshallah عز وجل. First thing is concerning a dawah in Allah, giving dawah. Everybody here, as individuals, families, community, we're responsible for giving dawah in Allah. It is a contract and a responsibility that Allah Azza wa Jalla has taken from us and He has put on us. كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَتَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Allah said, you're the best people who have been brought forth for the betterment of mankind, because you believe in Allah, you're enjoying the good and you stop the evil. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in ayah, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Let there come from you a group of people who will enjoin the good. That's responsibility in our community. All the drama we see going on around us, we have a religious responsibility to da'wah Allah. From a da'wah Allah, obviously, is al-amr bil-ma'roof and al-nahy al-munkar. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to take the bay'ah from his companions. A man wants to embrace Islam, sometimes he would just come, shake his hand, say, okay, you're Muslim, keep it moving. But sometimes he would take the man's hand and say, okay, I accept your Islam and your bay'ah under the condition that you give nasiha to every Muslim that you come in contact with. And he didn't take the bay'ah from people on things except that they were important. So everyone, we have a religious responsibility to give a da'wah ila Allah. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلٍ مِّمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ الصَّالِحَةِ قَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Who is better in speech? No one has better speech than the one who calls to Allah and he does righteous deeds and he says, I'm from the Muslims. So if you're going to engage in speech, much speech is appreciated, is beneficial, it is rewarded. Tell my wife I love you, and tell my mother thank you, I love you. That's good speech. But there's no speech better than a da'wah in Allah. So as everybody knows here, Allah Ta'ala created us to worship Him. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ جِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونِ. I created the jinn and mankind for the sole purpose of worshiping me. So it's my responsibility to worship Allah. And also, it's my responsibility to do the best that I can to remind other people as well. You have to worship Allah by doing it this way, doing it that way, whether they're Muslims or non-Muslims. So with that being the case, and with Ramadan coming, inshallah azza wa jalla, and with what you have of your life, I say that I advise to make the life that you have something that you're utilizing in al-khayr. And from the best things is a da'wah ila Allah. Don't be afraid and don't be shy to say the truth if you know the truth, especially in the month of Ramadan, especially. The reason why I'm mentioning all of this, Ikhwani, is because maybe you don't know. Five prayers in al-Islam, they're wajib. Everyone knows Salatul Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, wajib. But those are not the only wajib prayers in Islam. Salatul Eid, Eid al-Adha, Eid al-Adha, Eid al-Fitr, there are two prayers in wajib. Also, the Jum'ah prayer is wajib. It's wajib prayer. It's wajib. You have to do it. And from the prayers that are wajib is what the Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إذا دخل أحدكم المسجد فلا يجلس حتى يصلي ركعتين. If any Muslim enters into a masjid, don't sit down until you pray two rakat. So the two rakat agreed in the masjid is wajib. Maybe a person doesn't know that. If you don't know, it's no problem. Everybody was born and they came out of their mother's stomach and they didn't know. Every human being was like that. Every prophet, every messenger that came out of their mother's stomach, and they didn't have a lot of knowledge. They began to learn and develop, and they grew. And Imam al-Bukhari, Ibn Taymiyyah, everybody, that's their situation. That's their situation. But I just wanted you to know, and I don't want to take too much time, and at the same time, I don't want to take it for granted that everyone knows that, because everyone doesn't know that. The Prophet was given the Salat of Jummah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, given the khutbah of the Jummah. I hope you brothers are listening to me. He's given the khutbah of a Jummah. No time to waste. People came to listen. No time to lollygag. What he has to say is important. He's given the khutbah of a Jummah. One of his companions came in and sat down. In the middle of the khutbah, the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as-salaita ya as-salaita raka'atayn ya Sulayk. Hey Sulayk, Ghatafan, did you pray to rak'at? The Prophet didn't put him out on Front Street embarrassing him. He's showing that man what is important to him. Did you pray to rak'at? And that's a proof for our people in this country, Muslims who say that the Prophet is Hazir, Nazir, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knows the ilm al-ghayb. He asked him, did you pray to rak'at? He said, no, ya Rasulullah. He said, qum fusalliha wa tajawwaz fihima. Get up and pray them and make them quick. Don't make them long because I'm giving the khutbah. So the fact that he stopped the khutbah to tell that man to address the issue goes to show, ikhwani, those two rak'ats are important. Now what is amazing and makes the few hairs that I have on my head stand on end is that some of our community members don't know some of these basic issues of the hukuk of the masjid, what to do in the masjid, what not to do in the masjid. And yet we want to go to Syria, we want to make jihad, we want to establish the khilafah, we want to talk about the hukam and this and that. Every aspect of Islam is important. Establishment of the khilafah is important. Allah legislated jihad in this Quran. We're not going to be of the people who want to go crazy on one side and kill everybody and blow everything up. But we're also not going to be on the other side of the apologists who want to change the complexion and the reality of our religion. So the point here is, where is our ummah? Basic issues, the etiquettes of Jummah. The etiquettes of Jummah. We find Muslims don't know. Okay, no problem. The one who doesn't know, let's teach him. The issue is, as a person who's teaching, as a person who's giving da'wah, don't make your da'wah about those issues that are far out in the stratosphere, and we leave off those things that are right here. Like, don't be shy and embarrassed, Abdullah. If you didn't know, when you come to know, that's when you have to practice. So if any of you did not pray those two rak'at, don't feel embarrassed. Don't feel embarrassed. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told you, if you come into a masjid, don't sit down until you pray two rak'at. And the other issue concerning this and giving da'wah and advising the brothers is that when you do pray, you pray by yourself and pray those two rak'at. We saw some people in the masjid praying without a sutra. It is also obligatory upon you to pray with a sutra. Sutra being something that you put in front of you, and it has a lot of ahkam. You don't have the time to do that already, 10 minutes have passed by. May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us of the people who are the Ansar of the Sunnah, and may He subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those people who the Prophet will have intercession for them, Yawm al-Qiyamah, because of their love for the Sunnah, because of their desire to spread the Sunnah, and because of their lack of fear when it comes to the human beings about saying the truth when it's from the sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like it, like it, hate it, hate it. Today, inshallah, as you all know, we're going to deal with some issues concerning Ramadan. Now, I think that many of you have been exposed in the last few days about different lessons reminding you of Ramadan. What I can say at the top of the list, ikhwani, is, you know, they have a cliche they see in America. They say, the one who fails to plan, plans to fail. At least their dad, planning is really important in the deen of Allah Ta'ala. وَعِدُّوا لَهُمْ أَسْتَطَعْتُ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ مِنْ رِبَاطِ الْخَيْرِ تُرْحِبُونَ بِهِ عَدُوَ اللَّهِ وَعَدُوَكُمْ. Allah commanded, make preparations so that you can strike fear in the hearts of His enemies and your enemies. Make preparation. Jihad is not like that crazy, taking a kitchen knife to go fight a tank, taking rocks to go fight bombs and missiles. That's not our religion. And don't you come and tell me, وَقَتَلَ دَاوُدَ جَالُوتَ. Dawood killed Jalut. I know that. But Allah didn't tell us to go kill no Jalut with some rocks. You have to make preparation. You want to get married? You have to make preparation. Your wife is pregnant right now. You may not know what she's going to have, boy or girl. You don't know. But you still make preparations. Go buy a pram. You're going to buy a crib. You get the room ready for the kid. You may not buy pink clothes because you don't know, boy or girl. But you're going to make preparations. So our religion is like that. You have to make preparations. And preparations for Ramadan, it entails, and it dictates, it necessitates that everybody makes it this business to try to learn as much as he can learn from Ramadan. I don't care how long you've been fasting. There's a lot to learn about Ramadan. The ahkam of the iftar. How to break the fast. The ahkam of how to break the fast has a lot to know. The ahkam of suhoor has a lot to know. What about all of that other stuff in between? The ahkam of Ramadan, without being difficult and without any takalluf, without it being overwhelming, overpowering, the Muslim has a lot to know. And the salat is even more so. We've advised in this masjid many times, the book by an Imam Nasiruddin and Al-Albani Rahimullah Ta'ala, Sutatu Salat al-Nabi, that has been translated into English. We advise you brothers to get that book. We advise you sisters to get that book. The more you read that book, over and over and over, just like the Quran, every time you read that Quran, every Ramadan, from the beginning to the end, you're going to see things that it passed you by before. It's going to continue to reveal itself and unfold before you, Akramakullah. It's going to do that. Salat is like that as well. When you learn about this Salat, you're going to one time find this, you would do that, another time you change it. One time you do this, another, all of the dua to be said and so forth and so on. Ramadan is like that. Don't be like those people Allah described in the Quran from Quraysh. Those people Allah described from Ahlul Kitab, the Yahud and the Nasara. Don't be like the Sikhs and the Hindus. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى حَرْفٍ. They are those people who worship Allah, they don't know what they're doing. They don't know what they're doing. Man is fasting and not praying. And he doesn't even know what he's doing is incorrect. He doesn't know. He doesn't know. So I advise you brothers to take these days to become more serious about being students of knowledge as it relates to Ramadan. So that the individual can go in and come out and he maximizes, you know, his knowledge, maximizes the reward that he's in a position to receive, bi-idhnillah. So what I don't want to do is, I don't want to be repetitive. I don't want to mention what people already mentioned of the ahkam of Ramadan. Maybe during the Q&A session, those issues would come up. But what I want to do is I want to deal with an issue to remind you of, an issue to encourage you of, an issue that, inshallah, we don't want you to sleep on it. Don't sleep on it. Take advantage of this issue. And we use as a backdrop some things concerning the Jannah. The Jannah. The Prophet said about the Jannah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna fi jannati ma la aynu ra'at, wa la udhun sami'at, wa la khatra ala bal bashar. In the Jannah is what no eyes have ever seen, no ears have ever heard, and no human being has even contemplated. They don't have the ability to contemplate what is in that Jannah. Allah Ta'ala's Prophet said about that Jannah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, many things in describing that Jannah. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna fi jannati bahra al-ma, wa bahra al-asr, wa bahra al-ladan, wa bahra al-khamr, thumma تَشَقَقُ الْأَنْهَارُ بَعْدْ. He said, in the Jannah, there's a big river of water, pure water. There's another big, massive river of honey, a whole river of honey. And what does that look like? I saw a jar of honey. I saw a glass of honey. I saw honey in the bottle. But a whole river of honey, does that look like? And inside of the Jannah, there is a river of leaven, milk, that doesn't go sour and is flowing. He said, and in the Jannah is a big body of water or liquid that is khamr. Khamr. You don't get drunk when you drink it. You don't get high when you drink it. He said, after that, when the people go in, they see that. After they see those rivers, then the rivers of Jannah are going to start to flow. All of the other rivers are going to start to flow. How does that look? He told the people that, obviously, to give them knowledge. He told the people that, obviously, to show them the Qudra of Allah, the Quwwah of Allah. And he told the people that to make them, hey, try to get to that Jannah. Allah Ta'ala means many ayat about the Jannah. He said in the Quran, وَبَشِّرَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِ الْأَنْهَارِ كُلَّمَا رُزِقُوا مِنْ ثَمَرَةٍ رِزْقًا قَالُوا هَذَا الَّذِي رُزِقْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِ وَأُتُوا بِهِ مُتَشَابِهًا وَلَهُمْ فِيهَا أَزْوَاجٌ مُطَهَّرَةٌ وَهُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. Ya Muhammad, give glad tidings to those people who believe. Al-Iman, proper Iman. Not Hazim Nazim, not the Prophet Ilm al-Ghayb, not Abdul Qadir Ali al-Madid al-Madid, not magic, not all that hocus pocus nonsense. Tell the people who have proper Iman, proper Aqidah, and those who do righteous deeds, that they're going to have some Jannat levels, under which rivers flow. And every time that they are provided with something, some of the things that they are going to receive are going to be similar to the things that they had on the earth. Going to be similar. And they're going to say, hey, we had something similar to this before. And in that Jannah, they will have wives who are pure. They'll remain in there forever. So what the Prophet talked about, the Hurayn is a lot. A lot. Your wife, inshallah, in the Jannah will be better than the Hurayn. The lady has been married multiple times. Her husband died. She married another man. The Prophet, when he was asked that question, we have Hurayn, the men in the Jannah. What about the women? What do they have? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him that their husbands would be more efficient, more sufficient than anything. They said, but what if she had multiple husbands? He said, the lady would be with her last husband, and there won't be any animosity between them. So the point about the Hurayn, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that those Hurayn will be given some clothes, a dress. You lift up one dress, another dress, beautiful colors you never saw before. Lift it up, lift it up, lift it up, keep lifting the dress. And the man is enjoying the colors of the dresses. Then it gets down to the leg, the actual leg of the Hurayn. Then you lift up the leg, and there is her bone. And you can see through her leg to her bone marrow. You people know the bone marrow? That's the brown stuff inside of the chicken bone, inside of it. I don't want no bone marrow. I don't want bone marrow from the human being or the chicken. I don't even eat that stuff. But the ahkam of the Jannah, not like here. It's not like here. So the point here is, he explained in that ayah, azwajun mutahhara, so much about them. So a lot can be said about the Jannah, ikhwan, a lot. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, إن الأبرار يشربون من كأس كان مزاجها كافورا عينا يشرب بها عباد الله يفجرونها تفجيرا. The people who have a birr, the people who have a taqwa, they're going to drink from cups in the Jannah with something in it called kafur. What is kafur, Ya Abdullah? It's your religion. Part of al-Iman and Yawm al-Akhir. Part of Tu'minu billahi, malaikati wa kutubi wa rusuli wa Yawm al-Akhir. Part of belief in Yawm al-Akhir is to believe in things like that, because it's in the hereafter. What is the kafur? Allah Ta'ala said, the servants of Allah will drink from it, and everyone will have a number of cups that have been proportioned for him based upon what he or she did. And Jannah, so much has been mentioned about Al-Jannah wujuhum yawma'idhin na'imah li-sa'iha radiya fi jannatin aliyah la tasmaru fiha laghiya fiha aynun jariya fiha surrun marfu'atun wa akwabun mawdu'a wa namalik masfufa wa zarabi mabthufa. The Prophet used to read that Suratul A'la, Suratul Ghashiyah, every Friday. Most Fridays, he used to read Suratul Ghashiyah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the Salat of Al-Eid. And it is this description of Al-Jannah. All of that. So the reason why I'm bringing this to you, ikhwani, is this Ramadan, inshallah, Ramadan is an ibadah from the ibadat that is special. You want to get to Jannah? Ramadan is not something that just will get you into Jannah, but it will get you something special in the Jannah. It will get you something special. That Jannah, there's just a fraction of what has been in the Quran and the Sunnah. But those Jannahs are for who? Those Jannahs for who? You young brothers, and you too, my little sister, you young brothers, all of us, you have to remember, everything, without any exception, everything that Bani Israel did, everything that you know, Ahlul Kitab, everything that they did, our Ummah is going to do it, without any exception. Musa went up to get the revelation from Allah Azza wa Jalla, and Bani Israel remained behind, and they took a calf, an ijl, to be worshipped along with Allah. In our Ummah, there are people going to worship a calf. They're going to worship something other than Allah in our Ummah. The Jews and the Christians. The Jews said, Uzair is the son of Allah. The Christians said, Isa is the son of Allah. In our religion, there are going to be people right here in Luton, Birmingham, London, who say Rasulullah is from the Nur of Allah. He is the Nur of Allah. Everything that you can think of, they separated the church and the state. They separated our Ummah. They waited until Sunday just to worship. Just Sunday, 1 hour, our Ummah, like that. Everything. To the point that the Nabi said in two hadith, if one of them, if they went into a lizard's hole, you also gonna go into the lizard's hole. Another hadith said, if one of them were to have relationships with his mother in the middle of the street, you gonna do that. They broke off the divisions. They became divided. You're going to do that. The people who were given knowledge from amongst them, when that knowledge came to them, they became rough and tough with the community, and they drove the community away. And they started to rely on what's called al-amani. Al-amani is wishful thinking. Wishful thinking, where you just sit down and you say, I said, la ilaha illallah, I'm going to Jannah. Well, at least I'm a Muslim, so I'm going, that's wishful thinking. So the Jannah, ikhwani, is not for wishful thinkers. The Jannah is not for wishful thinkers. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He mentioned in describing those people from Ahlul Kitab, the Jews and the Christians, and He said, لَيْسَ بِأَمَانِيِّكُمْ وَلَا أَمَانِيِّ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ. This religion is not based upon your wishful thinking, Muslims, even Rasulullah, and He doesn't have wishful thinking. This religion is not upon what you want, Muhammad. One time these people, ikhwani, they cracked the Prophet's head open. They cracked his head open. They knocked his tooth out. Rasulullah became angry and he said, how and when would a people ever become successful who broke their Prophet's head and cracked his tooth? Allah Ta'ala revealed an ayat of the Quran. He revealed the ayat. وَلَيْسَ لَكَ فِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. You don't have anything to do with it. Whether Allah guide them or not. So he was cursing them in Salat al-Fajr. He was cursing them by their names. The hadith is Sahih Bukhari and Muslim. He went into ruku. He came up, Sami Allah liman hamida. And then he raised his hand. Whenever he cursed people, he would raise his hand and make kunut after ruku. And if he was just making dua after ruku, he would do it before the ruku. So if he wanted to make dua, Ya Abdullah, he wants to make kunut before saying Allahu Akbar and going down, he would raise his hand and make the general kunut. Allahumma dina fi man hadayt. He would say that, whatever. But if he wanted to make dua against someone, he would say Allahu Akbar and then come up from report, Sami Allah liman hamida, and then he would say, oh Allah, curse Al Harith ibn Aqwa, curse Amr ibn Zayd, curse this one, curse that one by their names. After he finished the salah, Allah revealed the ayat. You don't have anything to do with it. Don't curse them. And Allah guided those people to Islam. So Rasulullah doesn't deserve to be worshipped. And that's the point here. It's not based upon your wishful thinking, even Muhammad. And it's not based upon the wishful thinking of Ahlul Kitab. The religion is not wishful thinking. The religion is a dastur. It's a minhaj. It's been put there. We just have to learn it and follow it. It's not wishful thinking. Jannah is not wishful thinking. وَمِنْهُمْ أُمِّيُّونَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا أَمَانِيَ وَإِنْهُمْ إِلَّا يَظُنُّونَ. from them, Allah called them from the people, are illiterate, ignorant people. They don't know anything about the religion except with wishful thinking. So Jannah is not wishful thinking. Jannah is with actions. Jannah is with actions. Allah said about these special rooms that people will get in the Jannah. He said in the Quran, Subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَنُبَوِّئَنَّهُمْ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ غُرَفٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِ الْأَنْهَارِ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أَبَدًا نِعْمَ أَجْرُ الْعَامِلِينَ. Those people who believe, iman, and they do righteous deeds, they have birr walidain, they make tawbah, they have sabr, they do all of the good deeds. Allah said, we will prepare for them special rooms in Jannah. Rivers flow beneath those rooms, and this is a big ni'mah for the amileen, for the people who worked. Not the people who sat like this. Salafiyya, Salafiyya, our akhlaq from the Salafiyya. Where's the proof of that word? Where's the proof of that word? And perfection is with Allah, but there's a lot of kalam and a little bit of actions in comparison. Not wishful thinking. I have a monopoly on the truth because I'm Salafi. But my behavior isn't indicative of that. And I have the nerve to exist around people who may be better than me in their akhlaq, but he doesn't see himself as being Salafi. It's not wishful thinking. Kalam. Allah said in another ayah about those jannat. And then we'll move on and make our point, inshallah, as we do. لَكِنَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا رَبَّهُمْ لَهُمْ غُرَفٌ مِّن فَوْقِهَا غُرَفٌ مَبْنِيَّةٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ وَعْدُ اللَّهِ لَا يُخْلِفُ اللَّهُ الْمِيعَادِ. Those people who fear Allah with taqwa, they have a taqwa for their Lord. Allah Ta'ala has prepared for them special rooms in Al-Jannah. Special rooms. They are built upon each other. And their station, Mabniyatun, they are firmly established. This is the promise of Allah, and Allah won't break His promise. Prophet Muhammad said in the authentic hadith about these rooms. You have Jannah, then you have these rooms. He said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he used to take the environment and use the environment to teach the people because they knew their environment. He would give them a lot of lessons from the environment because he was a good teacher, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He talked to the people based upon their reality. Didn't talk above their heads, and didn't talk to them in a condescending way. And they used to be so mutahammis, haris. They used to be always waiting for each word to come off of his lips, to the point where he would ask them a question. Everybody knows the answer to the question. His performing at Hajj, he said, do you people know what month this is? Everyone knew it was Dhul Hijjah. They said, but we didn't say anything, think he's gonna name it a new month. Do you people know what day this is? Hey, everybody knew that it was the 10th of Dhul Hijjah. But he said, we didn't say anything. We thought he was gonna say it's a different day. Everybody knew what day it was. Do you know what city this is? They're in Mecca. They said, we didn't say anything, thinking he was gonna name it a new city. And one of the benefits of that, it goes to show you, Abdullah, how the companions, radiallahu anhum, used to look at the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They weren't like the people today, Muslim today, just the sunnah. The person comes today and he wants to argue, is weed halal or haram? Another one comes in and he says, on the TV, he wants to say, well, it's all open to interpretation. Everything him and his Pulliam Foundation has to say is against Muslims and Islam. Everybody else on the panel, he doesn't have anything to say. Just when a Muslim says something, he's just rough and tough. So the gay Muslim, and I don't put gay Muslims out of Islam, and I don't put them in the hellfire. As long as a person doesn't die making shit, he'll go to Jannah, inshallah. He says, oh, the lady says, hey, gayness, look, is haram, is clear in the Quran. The guy says, it's up to your interpretation. Okay then, the radical extreme Muslims, that's the interpretation of Islam. Why are you against them? So the point is, those companions listened to that kalam, ikhwani, and they didn't budge. The man came from over there. He said, Ya Rasulullah, can I kiss my wife while I'm fasting? He said, yes. The other man came. Everybody's sitting there. Ya Rasulullah, can I kiss my wife while I'm fasting? He said, no. The companions looked around. Now the single one stood up, what's this Bukhari or Sunnah Hadith or what is this? Not a single one said that. Look at this Sunnah, look, none of them said that. What did they do? They did what Allah told the Muslim to do. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرَ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ya Rasulullah, you said that to that man, and you said something else to that man. The one who had knowledge is going to explain to you. He said, yes, that man over there, he was a youngster. He was young. So I told him, don't kiss your wife. Don't kiss your wife, because you may not be able to control yourself. As for that man, Sheikh, he's an older man. You can kiss your wife. But the point is, the companions look, seems like, what? And then they ask the question. Not a single one of them got up and said, they're contradictions. I don't take the Sunnah, I just take the Quran. So concerning those special rooms, ikhwan, the Prophet said about those rooms, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that's in the Jannah, he said, just as you see the star twinkling in the sky, the Kawkab, the planet, on a clear night when there are no clouds, you see up in the sky the planets twinkling. The Prophet said the person who is in Jannah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be looking and he will be amazed and he will marvel at all of those rooms in the Jannah. They will be twinkling. He'll get enjoyment, al-istimta'. He'll get enjoyment from the visuals of what's going on. Not to mention what's inside of those rooms. He said about those rooms, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ فِي الْجَنَّةِ غُرَفَا يُرَى ظَاهِرُهَا مِنْ بَاطِنِهَا وَبَاطِنُهَا مِنْ ظَاهِرِهَا أَعَدَّهَا اللَّهُ تَعَالَى لِمَنْ أَطْعَمَ الطَّعَامِ وَأَلَانَ الْكَلَامِ وَتَابَ الصِّيَامِ وَصَلَّ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسُ النِّيَامِ. So he described them. This is what we want to deal with. He said, who are those rooms for? He said, Allah Ta'ala has created in the Jannah some special rooms. You can see the inside of those rooms if you're outside. And if you're inside of those rooms, you can see outside. Someone may say, well, what is the room made of glass or something? No, it's talking about something that no eyes ever saw, no ears ever heard of, no human being ever contemplated. It's a special situation going on, like khamr that doesn't get you drunk. May Allah forgive those of us who drink khamr in our lives. Like the milk that never goes sour. That's what the hadith is saying. You can see, alhamdulillah. You can see the inside of the room from outside, and if you're inside, you can see outside. He said Allah has prepared those rooms for four people. And all four of these people are people who do things in Ramadan. Now I'm gonna come inshallah after about 20 minutes, 30 minutes. I'm gonna say, hey you, Abdullah, Ahi, Bilal, Ahmed, hey Ghulay, hey Mustafa. I'm gonna say, what are these four things that the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? So I need you guys to concentrate. He said Allah prepared those rooms in Jannah for four people who do four things. The first are the people who feed other people food. They feed other people food. Number two, they're the people who alan al-kalam. When they speak gently. They're not swearing, cursing. They're not engaging in crazy kalam and crazy talk with their wives, their mothers, their friends, kuffar. Normally, the guy is okay. But as soon as he gets to that job and they're kuffar, he says things like, Jesus Christ. He normally wouldn't say stuff like that. But because they say Jesus Christ, he says Jesus Christ. They swear, he swears. Normally around the Muslims, he's not like that. Our kids in the school, because the kid feels that he has some freedom, they have a party. They have a party with how he articulates himself. Number three, the individual is the one who he fasts consistently. 29 days, 30 days. He doesn't just fast one day. He fasts for 29 days, 30 days. He fasts the fast of Shawwal, Thursday, Monday. But at least 29 days, 30 days. That comes under the realm and the umbrella of that hadith. And number four, the last thing, they are the people who pray at night while the people are sleeping. Again, four people. They're the people who feed other people food. They're the people who, when they speak gently. They're the people who they feed, they're the people who fast consecutively, consistently. And number four, they're the people who pray when the people are asleep. Each one of these qualities has its detail, but very quickly as a reminder. First one, those people who feed food. As an ex-Christian, and a person who traveled all over the world, you're not going to find a group of people, any nation, who have ikram al-dayf like the Muslims. You go to Africa, West, East, Central, wherever you go, Pakistan, wherever you go. When Allah chose the Arabs of Mecca to reveal the Quran in their language and the last Rasul with them, one of the reasons is that they were the best people in terms of akhlaq. And one of the things that the Arabs have is, ikram al-dayf. He may not pray, she may not wear hijab, get high, crackhead, something like that. But that individual, when it comes to the guests coming to the house, that's something from them. And for those of us who embrace Islam, that's something we learn from the Muslims. That's something you learn from Pakistanis, Indians, Afghanis, from the Muslims. Somali, that's just how it is. Western people, they have it a little, but it ain't in their religion. You may even come to the person's house, they never say to you, you want something to drink. They won't. And if they give you something, they may ask you. The man comes to the house of the Muslim to do electrical work, something. Muslim's gonna bring him some tea, gonna bring him some lunch, gonna do something for him. Because it's a part of our religion. And if you were to look, ikhwani, in this Quran, about the reward of feeding people, it leaves no doubt, no doubt. Allah has mentioned in the Quran, وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شَكُورًا إِنَّا نَخَافُ مِنْ رَبِّنَا يَوْمًا عَبُوسًا قَمْطَرِيرًا فَوَقَاهُمُ اللَّهُ شَرَّ ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ وَلَقَّاهُمْ نَضْرَةً وَسُرُورًا وَجَزَاهُمْ بِمَا صَبَرُوا جَنَّةً وَحَرِيرًا مُتَّكِئِينَ فِيهَا على الأرائك لا يرون فيها شمسا ولا زمهريرا ودانية عليهم ظلالها وذللت قطوفها تذليلا ويطاف عليهم بآلية من فضة وأكواب كانت قواريرا قوارير من فضة قدروها تقديرا ويسقون فيها كأسا كان مزاجها زنجبيلا عينا فيها تسمى سلسبيلا يطوف عليهم ولدان مخلدون إذا رأيتهم حسبتهم لؤلؤا منثورا وإذا رأيتهم ثم رأيت نعيما وملكا كبيرا عاليهم ثياب سندس خضر واستبرق وحلوا أساور من فضة وسقاهم ربهم شرابا طهورا. That is 20 things that Allah made for the person who feeds someone food in Jannah. To take the time out just to talk about the pool of Salsabil and what the Prophet said in this ayah, what the Prophet said about it, it's the rest of the class. We don't have time for that. But they'll get Salsabil. They'll get a glass in the Jannah, a glass, and it is Zanjibil. What's Zanjibil? Zanjibil is some khamr mixed with some ginger. Khamr and ginger. What is that? It's something special over here. Allah said in that ayat, يَتُوفَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلْدَانٌ مُخَلَّدُونَ. There will be servants for them, each one. He'll have a bunch of servants, a bunch of them. They will come and go according to what he wants. Hey, take that to Abu Bakr. Hey, take that to my mother. Hey, go and get me this, go and get me that. Allah said in that ayat, they will be scattered around like pearls, the way they look. Pearls going all over the place. And everybody has them. So you don't have time to explain all of what's been prepared just for the one who feeds food in the religion of Islam. And feeding food in the month of Ramadan is from the most important aspects of Ramadan. Not feeding food is a mushkila. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Mudathir about the people who wound up in the hellfire. مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرَ قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ ولم نكن نطعم المسكين وكنا نخوض مع الخائدين وكنا نكذب بيوم الدين. Hey, you people, what wound you up in the sucker, in the hellfire? Why did you people wind up in? They said, because we didn't pray. We used to didn't pray. And also, we didn't feed the miskin. So we wound up in the hellfire because we didn't feed the miskin. So concerning this issue, a lot can be said. I just want to remind you, when I came into the door, I saw that there's a loha or a list for people to feed the people on the days of Ramadan. I saw about three or four names on the list so far. I think inshallah, after today's talk, some of you guys will take responsibility because of the reward in feeding people. The Prophet said about Ramadan, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من فطر الصائم كان له مثل أجر مثل أجري مثل أجره إلا لا ينقص لا ينقص أجر صائم شيئا. Anyone who breaks the fast of the person who's fasting, he will get the reward of his fast without their fast being decreased one bit. Now this is important, ikhwan. For those of you who, after you became bad, the person who has to fast, the Muslim who is aqil, he's baligh, he's old enough, mature, he has the ability, and he's not a musafir, that person is the one who has to fast. So the Muslim who is not baligh doesn't have to fast. He has to be baligh. How do we know that the person is baligh in Islam? We know that the person is baligh for the boy, three things, and the girl, you add one thing. How do you know the girl is mature, the boy is mature, they have to fast? Your sister, niece, uncle, your brother, whoever. The girl, the boy, both of them. If they have pubic hair, they're baligh. He's 11, 12, pubic hair, he's baligh. Number two, if he doesn't have pubic hair, but he or she reaches the age of 15, they're baligh. They have to fast, have to put on hijab. If either one of them, if either one of them has the ability to have a wet dream, akramakum Allah, and ihtilam, then they're baligh, either one of them. So that's for the boy and girl. Pubic hair, baligh. Don't have pubic hair, 15, baligh. They have the ability, they have a wet dream, baligh. And for the girl, if she has her period, akramakum Allah, she's 11, 12, had a period 13, before 15, she's baligh. She wear hijab and stuff like that. So the point here, ikhwani, concerning this particular issue and feeding, some of us have been baligh. We were 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 1, 2, 3, and we didn't fast all those years. We didn't fast all those years. Some of us broke our fast intentionally. And if you break your fast intentionally, you have to free a slave. You can't free a slave, you have to fast 2 months consecutively. If you can't do that, you have to feed 60 people. So many people make mistakes. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us about salat and fasting as well. He said, Yawm al-Qiyamah, Allah Azza wa Jalla will look at the slave and you say to the Malaika, look at the salat of my slave. Did he complete it or did he not complete it? If he didn't complete it, Allah will say, look at the nawafil of my slave, the nawafil prayer. Complete the wajib prayer with the nawafil. The Prophet said, ثُمَّ تُخَذُ الْأَعْمَالَ لَذَٰلِكَ. And then all of the deeds will be like that. So a person who missed salah, he missed salah. The way he can make that up is to make tawbah to Allah, make tawbah, and then pray tarawih in Ramadan. Pray as much as you can pray nawafil. Those nawafil will complete what you missed. Ask for what they tell us in our culture, make qadha. So the person is praying for 10 years, he didn't pray. How in the world are you gonna know how many prayers you missed in 10 years? It's not even possible. You don't know. So do what the sunnah showed you to do. The hadith said, and all of the deeds will be like that. So if a person missed prayer, if he missed Ramadan, then let him make a lot of nawafil. If he missed fasting in the past, make nawafil. And also, give people food because you'll get the reward of their fast. You'll get the reward of that individual's fast. A lot can be said about that, but we have to move on. What time is the Salat al-Adhan?
The second issue, ikhwani, is critical, and that is, yarhamakallah, for the people who are going to receive those rooms or the people who have soft kalam. Soft kalam, what it means here is they're not nasty in the way they speak to people. They're not rough and they're not tough. Their dawah is not rough and tough and it's not nasty. As you all know, Allah sent Musa and Harun to Fir'aun, and Allah used that same word in this hadith. وَأَلَانَ الْكَلَامِ أَلَانَ الْكَلَامِ أَلَيِّنْ to, they make kalam soft. Allah told Harun and Musa, اِذْهَبَا إِلَى فِرْعَوْنَ. You too, go to Fir'aun. وَقُولَ لَهُ قَوْلٍ لَيِّنَا لَعْلُمْ يَتَذَكَّرْ يَخْشَى. You too, say a nice word. Tell him some easy words. It may be that he will reflect and have khashya. Take it easy with that guy. Some of the dawah with the people today who claim a monopoly are on the sunnah. He tells you, hey, Lucas 8. I don't drink Lucas 8. Me, I don't drink Lucas 8. But he says, Lucas 8, the orange one is the best one. It's the best one. I say, no, I don't like Lucas 8 orange. I like the other Lucas 8. He argued, no, it's the best one. It's the best. No, may Allah break your back. And that's his dua. Because I didn't agree with Lucas 8. He asked Allah to break my back. Because I don't see that particular sheikh's opinion or position in some issue is correct. Your dua is, may Allah break my back. The Nabi made dua against those people. Allah cursed. Al-Harith ibn Aqwa cursed. Al-Harith cursed. Allah said, you don't have anything to do with it, Ya Muhammad. Listen, ikhwani. The jihad, the Ramadan of the companions, they made jihad and they went to Badr. They walked from Medina and they went to Badr. They made jihad. It was a tough situation. Allah is not asking us to do that. Allah is not asking us to do that here, this month, inshallah. He's asking us to make the jihad of watching what you say. There's a companion, his name is Abdullah ibn Sufyan. He came, he said, Ya Rasulullah, ma huwa akhwaf shay takhafu alayya. What are you afraid for me the most out of all things? Is it Dajjal? Is it Shaytan? What are you afraid of me the most for me? He said, Hada, I'm afraid for you the most, this thing right here. So during the days of Ramadan, one of the things that we have to do in the month of Ramadan is we have to be on top of our tongue. We have to make that jihad. He said, "Afdarul jihad, and yujahid al-mar nafsuhu fi dhatillah wa hawa." The biggest, the best jihad is for a person to make jihad against his nafs and his desires. And from his desires is what his tongue says. That lady, that wife, that mother who has difficulty in speaking to her husband with respect. She has difficulty in talking to her children with nice terms. She has bad tongue. She'll destroy her Ramadan in the fasting by what he said, what she says, and how he says, arguing with people. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, laysa siyam min al-akli wa shurbi wa innama siyamu min al-lagwi wa rafath fansabaka ahadun faqul inni sa'im. In Nisa'im, he said, fasting is not leaving your food and your drink. That's not the real meaning of fasting. Right now, no one's eating and no one's drinking, but we're not fasting. We're not eating, we're not drinking. He said, fasting is not leaving your food and your drink. He said, fasting is leaving off a low, vain speech and a rough speech that is lewd. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنَ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِدُونَ. The believers will be successful. Those ones who, when they pray, they fear Allah. They are there in their mind. They're doing it the right way. And they're the people, when they come by vain speech, they walk away from it. He doesn't have time to be watching the World Cup. He doesn't have that time. Now, I came from a place, ikhwani, where we don't deal with soccer. Soccer wasn't never part of our culture. But we had basketball, American basketball. And that, in the month of Ramadan, was a fitna when the championship used to be in the playoffs. When the playoffs and the championship was in Ramadan, it was tough. So sitting before you is not someone who is, you know, flying with the malaika, and I don't know the reality, but the real reality is that World Cup is going to be one of the most effective weapons of shaitan to destroy people's Ramadan. It's a waste of time. The best game, and we're talking about people do have skills with that ball. Gotta give it to them, they got skills. The best game of the World Cup is not worth losing Ramadan over. It's level. Allah mentioned the believers in the Quran, وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِاللَّوِ مَرُّوا كِرَامًا. When the believers go by that stuff, they just keep it moving. They just keep it going because they have more, better things to do. So the point here is, we have to be responsible for our tongues. In the month of Ramadan, before Ramadan, after Ramadan, don't destroy your fasting because of your lisan. Rasulullah said to his companion, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَنْ يَدْمِنْ لِي مَا بَيْنَ لِحْيَيْهِ أَدْمِنْ لَهُ مَا بَيْنَ لِحْيَيْهِ وَمَا بَيْنَ رِجْلَيْهِ أَدْمِنْ لَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. If any one of you can guarantee me you'll take care of what's between your lihya, you take care of your tongue, you guarantee me that, and you guarantee me what's between your two legs, akramakum Allah, your private part, he said, I guarantee you'll go to Jannah. So if a person takes care of that in Ramadan, he's guaranteed to have a Hajj, a Ramadan that's accepted. But it's not easy. And again, ikhwani, again, the person comes to the masjid and we all experience this, Ahl-Sunnah, Al-Iman, we believe it goes up and it goes down. It goes up when you obey Allah, it goes down when you disobey Allah. It consists of your words, it consists of your actions and what you believe in your heart. So when Ramadan comes, we all experience that ziyadatul iman. Because we come to the masjid after getting suhoor, we don't a lot of time come for fajr, but we come to the fajr in Ramadan, we sit there, we make the dhikr, we make the salat al-ishraq, and then we go. But as soon as we start mixing with the people, that's when the fitness starts. That's when you start to use that language that Allah legislated Ramadan to be against. So the places in Jannah are for the people who talk easy, they mind their own business. For the people who are educators, mothers, fathers, the imam in this masjid, whoever gave a khutbah, if you take it easy in giving dawah to people. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not nasty in his dawah. As-salafiyya, ikhwani as-salafiyya, it is al-Islam al-Musaffa, it's the pure Islam, it is the Islam. And anyone who has an iota of common sense and he read the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sees that the Prophet had a consistent pattern of being nice and gentle with the people. And I'm talking about people who deserve for their heads to roll. They deserve to get their heads chopped off. And I mean like figuratively, like. I don't want anybody saying, who was telling them to chop the people's heads off? I'm not telling anybody to chop nobody's head off. I'm telling people did things back then where they deserved to be dealt with. And he didn't deal with them in a rough way. He dealt with them. And then here I come saying, I'm the closest on the sunnah. And I'm rough and tough and I'm nasty with everybody who disagrees with me. And you disagree with me, you're gonna get it. A tongue lashing. He does this, and the other one does it. One says, may Allah break your back for not doing it. Who in his right mind? Who in his right mind thinks dawah's like that? His right mind. Going over, for you young brothers, going over to Syria. Don't go to Syria to engage in any war. That's fitna fawda. Don't go over there. Who in his right mind is going to leave the streets of Luton, 17 years old, 18 years old, and he goes to Syria, and he didn't tell his mother and his father, and then his mother comes on the TV, BBC, whatever those news channels are, and she says to her son, I don't want you over there. I didn't like what you did. Come back. If I die, it's going to be in front of your neck, your kiyama. What are you doing? Come back. You're my only son. Who thinks like that? Who thinks like that? Our religion, ikhwani, is not based upon just haphazardness, just how you feel. Allah said about his religion, وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدْلًا. this religion has been complete in truthfulness and justice, not kadhib and dhulm. And another ayah said, وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ الْحُسْنَى. This religion has been completed with goodness and husna, not with confusion. So people of the sunnah are the people who in reality, they speak easily, they speak gently. They speak the Quran that is wise. And speaking gently doesn't necessarily mean you have to talk like this really low. They said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إِذَا خَطَبَ اشْتَدَّ غَضَبُهُ عَلَى صَوْتِهِ وَأَحْمَرَّتْ عَيْنَاهُ كَأَنَّهُ مُنذِرُ جَيْشٍ. If Rasulullah gave the khutbah, his anger became strong, his voice went up, his eyes became red, and he was talking to the people as if he was warning them of an army that was about to come. So لِكُلِّ مَقَامٍ مَقَالٍ. So every place is a time and a place. Speaking correctly doesn't mean like that. Someone can't hear you. Like, it doesn't mean that. It means having control. Speak with a lean. Take it easy. Have control. The third thing, ikhwani, is that they follow up Ramadan. Or they follow up fasting. From this is to fast 29 straight days, 30 days. Which is a dalil that the scholars use to say, if you travel, don't break your Ramadan. Some scholars took this as a dalil. They follow up and they keep doing it. So if you travel, fast in your trip. This is a dalil that some of those scholars use. If you can fast, fast. If you don't want to fast, you don't have to fast. Both sides, they have their benefits. Both sides have their benefit. As for fasting, the man came, Abu Umama radiallahu anhu, he said, Ya Rasulullah, dulluni ala amalin adkhulu bihi al-jannata. Guide me to something, Ya Rasulullah, that will get me into the Jannah. Guide me. Rasulullah told him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, alayka bis-sawm, fa-innahu la mathila lahu. I advise you to fast because there's nothing comparable to it. You want to go to Jannah? Then fast. There's nothing like it. Nothing. He said about this fasting, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna fil jannah babin yuqalu lahu ar-riyan yadkhuluhu as-sa'imuna yawm al-qiyamah la yadkhuluhu ahadun ghayruhum fa'idha dakhulu ughliqa. Verily in the Jannah there is a bab, that door is called ar-riyan. No one will enter to that door except the fasters. Once they go in, the door is going to be locked and closed. And then they're going to be drinking some special stuff in that place. And that's for the people of Al-Jannah. The people of Al-Jannah, some are not fasting. There's an ayat, وَلِكُلٍ وِجْهَةٌ هُوَ مُوَلِّيهَا فَاسْتَبِقُوا خَيْرًا. Everyone has his path that Allah put him on. This brother's path is, he's going to pray in the first row. That brother's path is, he gives sadaqah fi sabilillah. That brother's path is, when he makes Umrah al-Hajj, he knows what he's doing. We bring him with us for Umrah al-Hajj because he knows Umrah and Hajj. That one over there, he does all of the adhkar. He knows the adhkar. All of the adhkar of Salat, he can mix it up, the dua, he knows. Daytime, nighttime. That one over there has birr walidain. Nobody is like him when it comes to birr walidain. Everybody got his thing. There are some people who, their dad is fasting. That guy can fast. Some of us not fast. Last time we fasted was Ramadan. That's how it is. But if an individual were to fast Ramadan correctly, just Ramadan correctly, he'll be able, inshallah, to get into the door of Ar-Rayyan, because it says only for the fasters. It didn't say that people fast Ramadan and other than Ramadan. It said that people fast. They fast consecutively, 29 days, 30 days. And we have to imagine, ikhwani, like in Jannah. In Jannah, there is no jealousy, there's no rancor. There are darajat in Jannah. Darajat. People be high by the illiyin. People will be up there close to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah put us close to him. And people be lower. The Prophet said that, and the eyes of the Quran, they said that the people who are above, they're the ones who will come down to visit people below them. And not the opposite way. People below won't go up. Because if they went up, they'll be seeing stuff that they don't have. And there's no opportunity for al-hasad and haqd. in Jannah, none of that. So the people who come down, they already have that, so they come in, they visit each other, and there's love, nothing but love. So there's no jealousy. But when those people who fast go in the door, Rayyan is locked on the other people, they're gonna wish that they were inside. They won't be hating on them, but they're gonna wish. So if those of you who have children, hey, put your hand up if you have children. Do you have any children? All right, put your hands down. May Allah bless all of your kids. Put your hands up if you don't have children. If you don't have children, Masakeen, Allah give them children. Allah give them righteous children. All of you, get you married, and those who are married, may Allah make it easy. If you can imagine those of you who have children, when they told you your wife had the child was born, and you rushed off to the hospital to see that kid, boy or girl. You got to the hospital and there was the door, and your child was on the other side of the door, your wife was on this side of the door, your family on this side of the door, the child's over there, so I want to get in and see my baby. They say the door is locked. Can't get in to see the baby. It's going to affect you. The man is extremely hungry. He's extremely hungry. He wants to eat. He goes on, he wants to go to food, nice food on that side, the drink. They say the door is locked. Can't get in. The mother, the father have an issue with the child. They're telling the child, don't do this, don't do that. Child goes into the room and slams the door, locks the door. Father goes in to deal with it. He goes in, the door is locked. Whatever the scenario is, being locked out of a door is a mushkil. A door that you want to get in. So if you want to get into that bab of Ar-Rayyan, one of them is, it's an opportunity. Fast of Ramadan is one of the rooms from the rooms of Al-Jannah, the special rooms of Al-Jannah that Allah Azzawajal made for those three people. Last one, very quickly, Akhwani, although it should be mentioned even more, is those who pray when the people are sleeping. Qiyamul Layl. Qiyamul Layl, Ikhwani, begins. Qiyamul Layl begins after Salatul Isha. And we know that because Salatul Witr, the Prophet says, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Ij'alu al-Witr akhir salatikum bil-layl. Make the Witr the last prayer you make in the nighttime. So if you go to sleep and you want to get up and make tahajjud, you can. But if you want to just go to sleep and not wake up until Fajr, inshallah, you can make it witr right before going to sleep. So he said, make the witr your last prayer during the night. Qiyam al-layl begins at Isha. After Isha, khalas Qiyam al-layl. An individual prays two sunnahs of Isha, he prayed Qiyam al-layl. It does not necessitate that you pray Qiyam al-layl in the last third of the night or the last half of the night. It's better. Last third is better. But Qiyam al-layl after Salatul al-Isha. So the one who prays anything today, Qiyam al-layl, and people are sleeping right now, especially in these countries where we're living right now. But even more so in the month of Ramadan. In the month of Ramadan, again, those people who miss prayers, make up those prayers. And yes, you missed a lot of prayer, man. You missed a lot. So praying Ramadan is tough. Taraweeh is tough. It's tough. But you missed a lot of prayers. And how are you going to get rid of that? You're going to do that thing that they teach us in the culture? Old lady is 60, 70 years old. 70 years old. She's trying to make up 25 years of prayer. Making qadha. Even the regular Muslim, when he becomes a Muslim, I remember I became a Muslim in 1986. And I was with Asian people. They told me the Nawafu prayer, there was just so many, it was about 100 of them you had to make. The Nawafu's connect to Dhuhr, Asr. I was like, where did this come from? Then later on I found out, those people was making stuff up. And that's important again, Ikhwani, about that food. I have to make mention of this. Those revert brothers in this community, those reverts, especially like the white brothers and the black brothers. Not so much the Sikh and Indians, but them as well. But the black brothers and white brothers, Chinese people. In the month of Ramadan, you guys have to support those people. You guys have to invite those people to your house because they don't enjoy Ramadan the way you enjoy Ramadan with your family. They don't enjoy Eid the way you would. And now with the hours being so long, the individual gets waswas from shaitan who comes to him and says, man, this is long. Break my fast. So those people, they deserve our support. And they also deserve that you look for them and you search them out and you say, hey, this day, that day, come break your fast with me, come eat with me. And breaking people's fast, it doesn't mean that you have to give them a big walima, a big meal. Be the one who brings the dates to the masjid. You bring your dates and give people your date. If he breaks his fast on your date, on the water that you poured, then that individual will, you'll get his fast. What about him bringing water, he bring dates. Allah give you your niyyah. Allah gives you based upon your niyyah. The thing is, don't be bakhil on yourself. Don't be bakhil. So inshallah, we want to try to get more names on that list, inshallah. And this is one of the best things, services, social services that we can afford to our brothers who are Ghuraba. Even some of the Arab brothers who came from Morocco and Algeria, they're here by themselves. They have shared accommodation. They're not eating well. Ramadan is the opportunity for people to develop this al-akhwa. Concerning Salat, the nighttime prayer, a lot can be mentioned, but we don't have a lot of time, inshallah. We don't have a lot of time. We want to deal with some of the questions that the people had them, because that was part of the program. We ask Allah by His greatest name to give us tawfiq, inshallah ta'ala, to make this a blessed Ramadan, unlike any other Ramadan, where we're able and capable to complete the Quran and to contemplate on the Quran, to pray more, fast more, and to also make tawfiq from the mistakes that we made in the past, whatever those mistakes happen to be. أَقُولُ قُولِي هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ وَلَكُمْ وَنَسْأَلُ اللَّهِ التوفيق والسداد. Brothers, have any questions, you can put your questions on, general questions about Ramadan or specific questions about today's talk. But before that, the four people that Allah prepared those rooms for, they did four things in order. Four things. My man, what's your name, man? Suhail? Suhail. What were the four? I hate Suhail. He feeds people. Good job. Allahu Akbar. Good try, Suhail, but you blew it. What's your name, Akhi? Umar, where you from originally? You're not from Holland, huh? Holland. Okay, what are the four? Who are the four? Good job, Suhail, one. Feed people, good job, Umar. Speak gently. Fast continuously. Pray when the other people are sleeping. Got that, Suhail? Pray when other people are sleeping. Those are the words of the Nabi. I'm not saying that to put anybody down. Just saying that to remind you, that's all. Any questions, Ikhwani? My man. Person is traveling, his job is traveling. He's an airplane pilot, he drives a truck. His job is to travel from city to city, place to place. What can he do? Allah Azza wa Jalla allowed him to break his fast. He mentioned in the Quran, من كان مريدا ومن كان منكم مريدا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخرى. Anybody who's sick, anyone who's traveling, he can make him up from another day. Prophet told Anas ibn Malik, رضي الله عنه من الله وضع إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَضَعَ الصِّيَامِ أَنَا الْمُسَافِرِ وَالْحَامِلُ وَالْمُرْدِعِ. Allah has taken fasting off of the one who was traveling, off of the lady who was pregnant, or the lady who was suckling a baby. So if your job, that's your job every day, that's what you do, nobody can come with his mind and say, no, but that's your job. Nobody can do that. You're a traveler, so you can break your fast. But you owe those fasts. And to make them up outside of the days of Ramadan, you have to consider all of those variables. You have to consider that. So if that's your situation, then Allah Ta'ala has made it easy. There's an ayah about fasting where Allah Ta'ala said, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. Allah wants ease for you. And He doesn't want difficulty for you. Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, he went to a place called Azid Jinban. What's that place called again? Azerbaijan. He went up to that place, him and some companions in Tabi'een. They shortened their prayer for 2 years. 2 years. 2 years. 2 years. Now, tafadhal. My man, تفضل يا أخي. فايزي. السلام. Where is Mumsy? Oh, okay, Mumsy. Those are two old heads from the old school. تفضل يا أخي.
If someone overslept and missed Fajr in the mosque in Ramadan, where it was still dark outside, and they ate, would their fast still be valid?
If they overslept and there's still time for.
They missed Fajr in the mosque and it was still dark outside, and then they ate and drank, their fast would be valid.
Certain eating, once the time for Fajr comes in, it's not permissible to eat anything. Because it's made, there's a tahdeed that has been given to us. There's been a tahdeed, a limit that's been given. قُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ ثُمَّ تِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. Eat and drink until the Fajr time comes. The white thing, the right Fajr Sadiq, when that happens, eat and drink up until that point, but when that happens, stop. And fast up until Maghrib time. So if a person sleeps and wakes up and Fajr time is still in, he just prays. He doesn't take suhoor. He wakes up, Fajr time is still in, he makes a ghusl because he was junub. No problem, it doesn't destroy his fast. He just makes ghusl and he prays, but he can't eat once the time begins. Okay? Ahi Shaheed.
Someone gives da'wah, he's a noble da'wah, he sees that certain brothers have certain, their aqeed is completely wrong. He has to tell him. And what's the best etiquette way to tell him? Because he also that he's wrong, he has to tell him that what you're doing.
Certainly, the da'wah a lot, Khwani, the best way to get da'wah is clearly what the Quran is. Shown us in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that kana lakum fi rasulillahi uswatun hasana. He was a perfect example. He was a perfect example. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal mu'idha wa jadilhum billati hiya ahsan. Give da'wah to Allah. When you give da'wah to Allah and not to yourself, you tend not to get mad. You tend not to get upset and angry when he doesn't take it from you. But when you give da'wah to yourself and your madhab and your hizb, to your iman, to your group, your mother, your father, you get upset when people don't give it the program. So the ayah said, give da'wah to Allah with hikmah. Hikmah is wadru shaykh mahali and munasib, putting everything in a proper place. Say what should be said, the way it should be said, to what should be said. Sometimes hikmah is be quiet. And argue with them in a way that is best. Don't just argue for the sake of arguing. Argue in the way that is best. Itfa billati hiya ahsan. Push back, repel it with what is best, what is better. And you know, you have that ayah in the Quran that shows some people the best way of dealing with them is just leaving them alone and not even talking to them. Ibadur Rahman alladhina yamshuna fil ard. Allah Ta'ala mentioned about those Ibadur Rahman, wa idha khatabahum al-jahiluna qalu salama. Ignorant people are addressing them, hey, salama, I ain't got time for this. I'm fasting. I don't have time for that. The ayah of the Quran said, فَذَكِّرْ إِن نَفْعَةِ الذِّكْرِ. Remind them if the remembrance benefits. So we understand the مَفْهُوم الْمَخَالَةِ. The opposite of that is, if the remembrance doesn't benefit them, then don't remind them. So be easy. And don't jam up and spoil your Ramadan by arguing with people in the way that you're giving down. One of the ways of doing that is, Have an ikhlas. Person who is giving his da'wah to Allah for Allah alone. He's calling those people to Allah. When they don't accept, he doesn't take it personal. He doesn't feel that way. He doesn't like what's going on, but he doesn't take it personal. For the ayah. Where do you come from?
Ellsbury,
huh? Hey, is that your cousin who moved to Birmingham? Yes, a cousin. Fadda. Because I never heard of Ellsbury. And the brother came to me, talking to me the other day for the first time. He came to our community 3 months ago to come to Birmingham to be around more Muslims, the Sunni and things like that. He told me before the salah, before my class, so I said, okay, sit down. I told the brothers, hey, this brother just moved here. Give him some love. Find out his name. Know who he is. Welcome him. Help him out. That night, the brothers took him to eat. Next day, took him to eat. Invited him, giving him love, this, that. He's here in Birmingham 2 months. Now, recently, he went over to our Salafi brothers, and they told him, don't go to Green Lane. Why you don't go to Green Lane? Those people against the Sunnah. Those people this, those people that, those people. And every time they see him, they're pushing him. They're pushing him, pushing him, pushing him. And that's da'wah? And the reason why I'm telling you people this is, that's not da'wah. That's hisbiyah, that's shidda. That's not how we are to give da'wah and deal with people. We deal with people in a gentle, easy way. When people deserve to be dealt with rough and tough, they dealt with rough and tough, but not like that. Not like that. And then you find yourself in his cousin's position. People come and tell you, oh, those guys is up. Hey, look at for yourself. What did you experience? What did you hear? Ahi Umma, the reverb brother you brought, don't be of those people who you allow people to close your mind. Said the Sheikh said, all due respect to the Sheikh, I know Umma. I don't care what the Sheikh said. The Mahdi, Isa ibn Maryam, if he came back and told me that, then I'm going to accept it without any questions. I don't care what the Sheikh said. All due respect, I know that man. I heard, I saw from that man. I don't care what you tell me the Sheikh said. Don't be one of those people who like that. The Sheikh said, and you don't even know what the Sheikh said. That's not our down. That's some nonsense. This is the last question, inshallah, and we'll call it a day.
Tell the ayah. They read super fast, 20 with death. But when we do 8, we walk away, they look at us in a funny way. They say, why are you just no issue with the 20, because they look like the robots.
Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, was approached by a man who told him, I read Surah Al-Baqarah in one night, and I read it quickly. Abdullah ibn Abbas told that man, for me, he said to the man that he completes a large portion of the Quran in one night, reading it fast. Ibn Abbas told the man, radiallahu anhu, for me to read some of Surah Al-Baqarah with At-tadabbur and at-ta'ammul and al-khushur is more beloved to me than what you're doing. So the goal and the objective is not to get through that in one nafasa, just one nafas. They have a thing on the YouTube. My son told me, Abby, you're not going to believe it. I said, I believe it, man. It's 2014, I believe anything now. What's up? He said, look at this, Abby. The guy was called Ferrari Quran. Ferrari, the car, Ferrari. He put that thing on. That man went through Surah Al-Fatiha with one breath. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. And then the people started, Allahu Akbar, and everything was really quick. And any Arab, like me, my Arabic is da'ifa. Anyone who knows some Arabic, you can't understand what he's saying. You're talking about idgham from the ahkam of a tajweed, it's idgham, putting one harf into the other harf. That's idgham on another level, because everything is mixed up. And that, wallahi, is not salah. As the Prophet said, as Allah said, مَا كَانَ صَلَاتُمْ عِنْدِ الْبَيْتِ إِلَّا مُكَاءٌ وَتَصْدِيرٌ. Their prayer at the house, Kufar, Quraysh, Abu Lahab, it was nothing but clapping hands and whistling. They were having a party. They were not praying. That man came and he prayed very quickly, the Tahiyatul Masjid very quickly. Prophet said, Irja, fasalli fa innaka lam tusalli. Go back and pray. You didn't pray. So that is no salah. And you know, ikhwani, in closing, we have to be careful. The highest said, La wa la taqfu ma laysa laka bihi ilm. Inna as-sam'a wal basar wal fu'ad kullu ulaika kana anhu mas'ula. Don't talk about what you don't have any knowledge about. Don't put your foot in an arena you don't know. Just say, oh, I don't know. Because Allah is going to question about your hearing, your sight, and your heart, everything. So don't say something's haram, halal, you don't know. Don't say he's a mubtadi, you don't know. It's a calf, you don't know. I say, wallahi billahi tallahi, the one who fasts and he doesn't pray, he doesn't have any fasts. If he fasts and he doesn't pray, he doesn't have any fasts. No fasts, doesn't count. So I would say to this brother, da'wah and hikmah may necessitate, it's better not to pray in such a masjid. Because if you pray in such a masjid, you're going to get that look. You're going to get people looking at you because you're making a problem. And we don't want that. Taraweeh is the sunnah. Peace between the Muslims is wajib. It's from the awjib and wajibat. Taraweeh is the sunnah. And not getting into fights is haram. It's wajib not to get into fights. So if breaking off of them from those people is going to cause a problem, and you have other alternatives, then don't go there. But if you don't have any other alternative and want to hear the Quran, I mean, why are you going there? If they're praying that fast and stuff like that, you may be better not to go to that place. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and Ali ibn Abi Talib used to tell us, Ikhwani, حدث الناس على قدر أقولهم أتريدهم من يكذب الله ورسوله. Talk to the people according to what they understand. Do you want them to reject Allah and His Messenger? So talk to the people, deal with the people according to their level of understanding. Jahil, someone who doesn't know something, he's ignorant about it, he's an enemy to it because he doesn't know. This is the last question because my man was raising his hand for a long time. Real quick, man, can I?
Can you fast for somebody, not fast for many people?
It is completely, absolutely ijma between the ulama of al-Islam that you cannot fast on behalf of anybody, just as you can't pray on anyone's behalf. Can't pray for your mother, your father. Can't do that. Can't fast on anyone's behalf. Anyone. The only fast that you can do for someone is a fast where they died and they made another. They have an oath. They have to fix that oath. It's still in their neck. They didn't fast in the oath. They missed the oath. The man came and said, Ya Rasulullah, my mother died and she had the fast of the oath in her neck. Should I fast on her behalf? He says, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Deynu Allahi ahaqqu yuqda. The debt of Allah has more right that you take care of it. You owe somebody money, you have to give them money. But the debt that Allah, someone has with Allah, has more rights. So he allowed a nus, he allowed kalam, an incident where someone told him they have a debt, he allowed it. As for someone who can't pray, you can't pray on behalf of anybody. You can't fast on behalf of anybody who's alive. Some of the scholars said it's permissible if a person died or in days to Ramadan, it's permissible to make sawm on their behalf. Some scholars took that position and it appears to be a position that is marjur. Wallahu a'la and a'lam. We're going to stop right here, Ikhwani, and inshallah we'll call this a day. Thanking the administration here, my man Usama, for giving us an opportunity to come to you, brothers, to remind you about the Tawheed of Allah and the importance of the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the danger of a shirk and innovation and hisbiyah and hatred between ourselves. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك واشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك.